language revitalization. In the recent years, these terms have become very familiar. Language death, language endangerment, language extinction, etc. Languages are also classified in many ways. I'm sorry, again I hear some disturbances. I do not know, because it may not be clear to others. So please mute yourself. Thank you. The languages are also getting new labels. Like we talk about looks like I was also muted. Based on the criteria developed by UNESCO 2003, the UNESCO Atlas of the World's Languages in Danger, brought out by Mosley 2010, the third in the series, shows that 2,471 languages are endangered, out of which 197 of them are spoken in India. That makes it the country with the most endangered languages of the world. The Ethnologue 2020 lists 2,926 languages as endangered. Please compare the numbers of the previous year. It was 2,895. In 1 year, the numbers have risen. So we will come to that, why we see the increase in numbers. Whereas the Catalogue of Endangered Languages 2018 has identified 3,394 languages as endangered. Thus, the number keeps changing. The fact is, languages are dying faster than before. Here's a screen which displays the Census of India numbers. Not going into the details. If there is any query on this, we can always come back to it. We have 21 languages under Indo-Aryan, one in Iranian, Germanic, and other languages. You can see this is the grouping also, the family wise: Indo-European, Dravidian, Austroasiatic, Tibeto-Burmese. You can see there are 66 languages in the Tibeto-Burman group, and Semito-Hamitic also is there. Besides the above, the Census of India combines the mother tongues of 1,875,542 speakers, that is 0.15 speakers under other languages. The non-inclusion and marginalization of many languages with less than 10,000 speakers trigger emotional problems. And these are, of course, I think many of you know that the Census of India does not disclose the actual speakers of the languages which have less than 10,000 speakers, though the data is available with them. For various reasons, the government does not release those numbers. But we know that the communities with less than 10,000 speakers have so many emotional problems that could give rise to communal tensions in the respective states or union territories where they are predominantly spoken. As per 2011 census, with about 550 tribes, the scheduled tribe ST population constitutes 8.6% of the total population. I'm using the title of this slide only to be in line with the government labeling. Otherwise, I prefer to use the term indigenous communities or indigenous people. But this is just for administrative purposes. The government of India back then had classified as scheduled tribe. So I just, in some of my slides, you will see the names as the ST or the tribe. The ST population of our country constitutes 8.6% of the total population. And there are three distinct zones. Northeast India, at least 11% of the languages are there, the people, the speakers. Then in central India, when you see this, this is the speakers. The speakers seem to be more in the middle part, that is the central and east India. In southern India, the number of speakers are only 3%. Northeast India, we see 11%, but the number of languages actually are more in the northeast. And these languages are many unique in many ways. Even these three groups are unique in many ways. Most of the communities of Northeast India are economically and socially well-placed than the other two groups. They speak a variety of languages that are under-resourced, all the three groups, which are under-resourced, less explored, under-described, and very little documentation has been done so far. And many of these languages are unwritten too. What impact does documentation have on these communities? That's one question that may come to the minds of the academicians assembled here and also others who may listen to this talk afterwards. Many communities increase their efforts to reclaim, revitalize, and relearn their lost languages. There is an urgent need to preserve language. For the last two decades, we have been doing this task. How to do this? What is the first step? Language and cultural documentation seems to be the first step. That is what we have been doing right from, Boyesian era. What do we do here? What kind of outcomes do we get out of this documentation? A storehouse of knowledge resources, because it depends on how much we can elicit and how much we can document. The more the merrier. As much as we can, we should get it. Not just the language part, but also the cultural part. Now, what is the impact of this documentation on the communities? There can be positive as well as negative impacts. Language attitudes and heightened awareness of language endangerment within communities and in the broader society. For many of the communities, reclamation efforts, existing linguistic resources may not be relevant to their needs. Oftentimes they ask, it's not enough. Maybe when we are doing documentation, in earlier days, documentation was done mostly by or mainly by academicians. So the outcomes were also mainly useful for the academic community or the scientific community. It was very less of use for the community in earlier decades. In recent decades, we are seeing that the community is also involved and academicians want to work with the communities and develop materials or produce resources that can benefit the community. Because again and again, community is our number one priority. Because when we lose the community, we are losing the language. When we lose the language, the culture is lost. When all these things are lost, you know that if you imagine a particular community is wiped out from the world map, it is really sad that many such things are happening and we are losing several communities and thereby the languages and the also the culture. So I would like to introduce a few terms here and talk about revitalization. My main focus of today's talk is going to be on revitalization. The issues and challenges we have in front of us, especially with special reference to India. A few concepts first. Number one, linguistic human rights. Minority language right issues are not recent cases. These appeared in the Treaty of Bucharest in 1812 and the Treaty of Versailles in 1919 until the end of 19th century. Later on, they formed the base in the early 20th century for the formulation of domestic or international policies of different countries. We know very well UNESCO in many of its documents have been advising us, all of us, to look into the linguistic human rights of our own countries. The right to speak, to learn, to educate, and unfold this.
They have got to listen to Zoom.
I think some people are speaking in between. I hear some disturbances. I request the participants to please mute your mic. Thank you, because there were a lot of disturbance, I could not concentrate. Yes, once again, so linguistic human rights. Linguistic rights are the basic human rights. Linguistic majorities, speakers of the dominant language, usually enjoy all those human rights. In my previous slide, I was going to read the UNESCO's statement on linguistic human rights. The right to speak, to learn, to educate, and unfold all cultural activities in one's own mother tongue, in addition to other official languages, is enshrined in many of the constitutions of the world. But it is not happening everywhere. Though we know that linguistic rights are the basic human rights, it is mostly the linguistic majority, speakers of a dominant language, who enjoy all the linguistic human rights. Most linguistic minorities, including the tribal or indigenous languages in India, like the rest of the world, do not enjoy these rights. Again, my emphasis is only speakers of official languages in India, the 22 speakers of the 22 scheduled languages of our country, who enjoy all linguistic human rights. Thus, linguistic minorities are compelled to defend their linguistic rights. That is the reason where we see many conflicts, like language conflicts. Many such incidents have happened in our country, especially in Northeast India. I also would like to introduce two terms to many of the students who are in this group: language reclamation and language revitalization. Language revitalization is the topic of our web lecture series. Now, what is the difference between these two? What is language reclamation? This is a larger effort by a community to claim its right to speak a language and to set up associated goals in response to community needs and perspectives. Very few countries have language reclamation programs or activities, slowly coming up in different parts of the world. In our country, there are smaller groups who have started, or language activists and other people who have some kind of language reclamation programs, with their claim is, I want to use my language like other people do. Suppose you are a speaker of, say, I am a speaker of Tamil. I have the privilege of using Tamil in all walks of my life. And I could also attend civil service exams or any other activity using my language, any of the scheduled language. So, but many community members of the non-scheduled languages cannot do it. So it's not just the right to speak, but also the right to use the language in different domains of life. So this is one thing. Research in language reclamation is very, very little in our country. And I think India should take up such programs also. Language revitalization, a term familiar to many of you, which talks about revival of a language. I think in Julia Salabank's talk, already she introduced revitalization and the different models of revitalization. So some of you who have attended her talk or had an opportunity to hear it on YouTube must have understood the different models. I would like to just brief here that language revitalization has a primary focus on developing new speakers, as Hinton pointed out. That means we are interested in giving, why are we interested in reviving a language which is lost? Maybe the community is there. I can give one such example from Meghalaya, a Ruga community. The community lives in Rugapara, but there are only a few speakers, like three speakers, one, two full speakers and one semi-speaker. But they are very much interested in revitalizing their language because they want to develop new speakers. That means the people who are there, three generations of people live there. But unfortunately, only the older generation or the oldest generation, three people could speak. But they want to transmit that language to the younger generation so that their language can be revived. So that is one example where we are saying that focus is to develop new speakers where there are less speakers or no speakers. Of course, language revitalization is oftentimes driven by the crisis of language endangerment. When there is a fear of losing a language, then comes the task of saving it. How to save it? How to prevent language death? In this particular phenomenon, language revitalization is, of course, interdisciplinary in nature, and it is often socio-political, socio-cultural, with goals that go beyond the task of generating more speakers. Because it's not just generating more speakers. We should also see that the language is used in different domains, and also there are so many other issues which we will be discussing in this talk. Both these terms and phenomenon are popular, and they involve members of indigenous language communities, field linguists, social workers, educators, government agencies, and non-government organizations, and many others. A global upsurge in language revitalization is there in the last two decades. Many scholars see it as something about issues of self-respect and empowerment and reclaiming one's ethnic identity. Identity is something very, very important. When identity is lost, everything is lost. I would like to highlight some of the approaches about language revitalization, like language maintenance and promotion of languages. And from this, derive some themes which can be discussed and seen in the perspective of the Indian scenario. Yamamoto in 1998 puts forward several factors for language maintenance and promotion of the so-called small languages. I think there are 9 factors. Let's go through them one by one. The existence of a dominant culture in favor of linguistic diversity. This is one important factor. That is why among these non-scheduled languages of our country, you know very well, like there are small languages, we call them small languages, but then there are even smaller languages or smallest languages or even tiny languages. So, but then each time you see that a dominant language or a culture may be predominantly used in that particular region. A strong sense of ethnic identity within the endangered community, because all of us, I may speak a small or a smallest language, but still, I am proud to be the speaker of that language. It's my language. So that is why that sense of ethnic identity is another factor. The promotion of educational programs about the endangered language and culture, the creation of bilingual or bicultural school programs, because these are not common in India. We'll come to that. The training of native speakers as teachers. Suppose you want to introduce a bicultural or multicultural language or schools or special programs in schools, we may not have teachers. That is one factor. The involvement of the speech community, because it's very important. It is for the community we are doing revitalization. That means we need complete involvement of the speech community. The creation of language materials that are easy to use, because if it is not easy to use, it may not motivate the learners. The development of written literature, both traditional and the new, it's another factor. Many of these languages don't have script. When there are no writing systems, how are we going to develop the written literature? The creation and strengthening of the environments in which the language must be used. It is not enough, again going back to the Ruga example, Rugapara village, it is not enough just to develop new speakers in Rugapara. We should also create an environment where those people can use the language. I know that they are used, like there are interested people, when we were doing some small field work, when I was working in Northeastern Hill University in Shillong, I had a project with UGC, and one of my research fellows and I, his name is Vinayal in Good Hope. We went to Rugapara. When we were collecting data, eliciting data, there were some people, at least the grandson of the village headman, who used to sit with us with a notebook and write down the words, because he was very much interested and keen to know the vocabulary of his language, and he also tried to use it. But he was asking us, where will we use it? So that means it's again the community along with the state government perhaps, and maybe with the help of other academicians, should create the strength and strengthen the environments, the domains where this language must be used. Some of these are difficult to accomplish these nine factors in the Indian scenario for the lesser known languages. Nevertheless, attempts should be made. I also would like to draw your attention to David Crystal's six postulates for the theory of language revitalization. His approaches are, if you see that each of his postulates starts with an endangered language will progress if it speakers, and then he puts the rest of the clause. The colored text is just my own to emphasize the point. Let us see the first one. An endangered language will progress if its speakers increase their prestige within the dominant community. So it is important. How it is important, but as you know very well, it is not possible to clap with just one hand. We need two hands to make a clap. So therefore, there should be a lot of other factors involved. We will see how speakers can increase their prestige within the dominant community. An endangered language will progress if its speakers increase their wealth. I do not understand this part of David Crystal in one sense, but in another sense, I feel yes, maybe he just wants to say if wealth is increased and if you are having the wealth equivalent to the dominant community, maybe you will be recognized. In other words, it is getting some economic recognition, which can be in turn trigger the socio-economic relevance of that particular community. An endangered language will progress if its speakers increase their legitimate power in the eyes of the dominant community. So these three are with a reference to the dominant community. That is why I put the purple color for that second clause. Increase their prestige, increase their wealth, increase their legitimate power. It's not easy to do, but we have to make our efforts to do that. The next three postulates, an endangered language will progress if its speakers have a strong presence in the educational system. With the NEP 2020, the whole country is looking forward to see how we can get education in the mother tongue. But again, we have to see that for endangered languages, or what we are saying for endangered language is also applicable to the lesser known languages of our country, because it is not just for endangered, because we have 99 languages which are non-scheduled. Even for those languages, we have to see whether is it possible to bring some kind of presence, like in the educational system, will they get a place and will mother tongue education happen for those languages? That's one thing I think we should do our best to see that each and every community, because again, going back to the statement, linguistic human right is the basic human right, and education is our second basic thing. When you say, if I cannot use my language in the educational system, then I feel inferior to compared to the rest of the speakers in my own country. So that is why we need to do one thing. So an endangered language will progress if its speakers can write down their language. Writing their language down is important, because we know very well, like when we say scheduled languages of India, these are all well-established literary languages with lot of literature. So they have it own script, and basically writing systems are there. So one of the criterion for many of the lesser known languages of the country for not being able to be included in the scheduled list is because they do not have a script. But you may ask me, what about languages like Khasi, Garo, or Tadov, or other languages which do have a script, but still they are, did not get the scheduled status? There are other socio-political factors to this, which is beyond the scope of my talk today. The sixth postulate of Crystal, an endangered language will progress if its speakers can make use of electronic technology. Nowadays, everybody wants to be technologically empowered, and I support the idea of UNESCO, technology for all. So it's very, very important in multilingual world, especially in multilingual India, we have to technologically empower all our languages, especially the small languages. There are other approaches as well, but since there won't be time to go through everything, I would like to quote one more person, Daryl Kipp's pronouncement. He is a Blackfeet language activist, and he came out with three rules. This is citation from Rainer 2003. Rule one, never ask permission. Never beg to save the language. Go ahead and get started. Don't wait even 5 minutes. Don't wait for a grant. What does he mean by that? He's not being rude. He just wanted to say, like, the language is dying. Maybe there may be a lot of bureaucratic formalities. So maybe never ask for permission. Never beg to save the language. Go ahead and start it. Don't wait for a few minutes. Don't wait for a grant, even if you don't have money. But here it is not that simple as he put forward that rule. Because in my opinion, if one has to seek permission from the community, if we are interested in revitalizing the language or documenting their language, because language is like how our body parts are our own, language is their own. So it's important for us to seek permission. And next is, don't debate the issues. Of course, that is, I'm not going to debate about this rule number two here. But the idea here is, again, like, if he probably doesn't want to waste time on such things. Rule number three, be very action-oriented. Just act. I think that's very important. We have to be action-oriented, but again, work with the community. That will be my humble proposal to this August audience. Rule number four, show, don't tell. Don't talk about what you will do. Do it and show it. Yes, that's very important, because seeing is believing, we know that. So when can we see it? Only when something is done. So it's important to do something. And then maybe even if you want to do a small project on your own, and then convince the community whom you're approaching that this is something I have done, but it is not for my academic benefit. It is for the benefit of your community. And I would like to be part of your mission in saving your language. Can we work together? There are many approaches, but some of the things what Kip put forward worked for Blackfeet, but may not work for our country. But it's possible to come out with our own pronouncements. There are many guidelines, advice, and forms in the world, and some more terms which all of you are familiar. Language nests that originated in New Zealand in the 1980s as a part of the Maori language revival, which is a well-known phenomenon, very successful. And this has been implemented in many other parts of the world, in the United States too. Language nest is a translation of the Maori phrase Kohanga Ryo. Master apprentice system is another advice, and people afterwards changed it into mentor apprentice programs. I think this is possible in many of our communities, because many of the communities I know of, at least from Northeast India, do have some kind of system, like depends on the community and the state also, where there are bachelor houses, there are so many other houses, where the elders also train the young people in various things. So that kind of things, I feel this mentor apprentice program could be easy to do in Northeast India, and probably in also in South India and Central and East India, where we have the majority of the indigenous languages spoken. Linguistic human rights, again and again we are talking about this because it is important to emphasize their potential in revitalizing indigenous languages as a political act. This cannot be done by just you and I. This is again a government policy. One has to have coordination with the central and the state government and come out with some kind of policies to ensure that linguistic human rights of all our speakers of the various Indian languages. Political movements are also one form of revitalization. The best example for that is the modern revival of Hebrew or Basque and the language legislation of Cuba Quinta. So I just talked about some approaches and also highlighted some guidelines, advice and forms. From these approaches, I drew some themes which could be our focus for discussion today. Almost everybody is emphasizing on culture as one theme. There are many other themes. We will go one by one. So the first theme I would like to focus here is on language culture connection and the cultural awareness. Revitalization is not just about language, but also the culture of a community. We know very well because when we talk about culture, language, both are interrelated. I heard many of the Ruga community members saying the above quote in bold, we lost our language and are slowly losing our culture because the dominant culture in that region is Garo culture. So what these people do is they do have some festivals, Ruga festivals are there, then there are some Ruga dances and people wear the Ruga costumes and some rituals are performed. But like I told you, only those three speakers are aware of the, in other words, the cultural awareness is with them and they pass it on to the younger generation, but language is not being passed, is not being transmitted. That is one concern for many of the community members in the Ruga Para village. So we have to do some work and ensure that the communities also get cultural awareness. Cultural awareness is undeniably critical for success in a language revitalization initiative. Until and unless that awareness is created, the community may not be convinced to restore or revive their language. And only if you convince the community, it's very important the community comes to us, nowadays, of course, compared to earlier days, among the community members, many of them are highly educated and maybe those people would understand that cultural awareness goes hand in hand with language awareness and how we can use interconnect both. And also those people along with the elders in the community can provide some kind of cultural therapy, which may be seen as a means to improve cultural awareness. Because sometimes when we don't know something, we need therapy, right? So that is this idea is from Spindler 1999's work. So for establishing language cultural connection and creating cultural awareness, what can we do? Of course, working with the communities is important. Identify their needs and build a bridge between language and culture for revitalization. Community solidarity is another important concept. Without a degree of consensus, it is difficult to resolve language conflicts and issues. Without resolving language issues, it is difficult to revitalize the language. Winning the solidarity of community members is not an easy task, because that is why what is happening is ever since the UNESCO came out with the Year of Indigenous Languages, and also before that the Atlas came in 2009 and 10, and the list of the Red Book of Endangered Languages was prepared, the Atlas was prepared, and even from then onwards we see that a lot of people in India, the academicians, are working on endangered languages. But most important is many of them may not have the appropriate training in field linguistics. And also, why I am saying training in field linguistics is important is because there are ethics when we have to do field linguistics. So we have to follow the field linguistic ethics, professional ethics. Only then you will also learn how to win the solidarity of the community members. You want, how can you become one of them, and how you can involve community members. And among, if there are differences among the community members, how to resolve that, how to resolve the conflicts, and how to overcome all socio-political pressures and find a neutral solution. Academicians, language activists, and community members should also be on the same page with common achievable goals. Another important theme is indigenous community control. Community control must be respected and sincerely clasped in their negotiations. The best way to save a language is to protect the community in which the language is spoken. So in other words, we are saying that we are now coming to several issues here, not just language and culture, but also society. So it is important to protect the indigenous society where the community lives. And once a society is protected, community is protected, which entails the protection or preservation of the language. So that is one of the best ways. Linguistic diversity policies of a nation or state must recognize the dignity of peoples and communities that are the guardians of languages, respect their rights, and build genuine collaborations with them for language protection and promotion. This was the UNESCO statement in the Yulu Proclamation held in China in September 2018. So it's very important. Again and again, we are talking about recognizing the dignity of people and communities because they are the guardians of languages. They are not just the guardians of the languages, they are culture bearers also. So it's important to respect their rights and build genuine collaborations with them. Only then any activity related to revitalization or reclamation will be successful. Thus, community-directed planning and consultation is essential. Another theme that pops up all the time is genetic fallacy in bilingual or bicultural educational programs. Dauenhofer defines genetic fallacy as follows. Assumption that the ancestral or heritage language will be easier for a person of the same ethnic background, and teachers must also be of the ethnic group. So what are we trying to see here? This is actually the general myth. We are saying that most of the times in educational programs, if we want the teachers to be of the ethnic group, and also the assumption that the ancestral, or in our case, the lesser known language will be easier for a person of the same ethnic background. It need not be true. For example, if there is a Kukichin person, he or she may also like to learn, say, a Bodogaro language, may not be from the same ethnic background, but this assumption or this myth should be abolished, and it should be free. Like, okay, it's not just the larger group. You may say, okay, it may be easier, but that cannot be the only criterion for bilingual or bicultural educational programs, because language acquisition, of course, is different, but then one has to see how you can take the language to other communities as well, because it's, there are many people who are interested in learning other languages, even it may not be their mother tongue. Regaining a lost language is not easy. It requires long-term commitment and continuing support, because again, going back to the Ruga case, overnight we cannot develop resources or build dictionaries or develop primers, set up bilingual or bicultural schools. It's not possible. But short-term programs can be started. Again, we need to have a dialogue with the village headman and the state government. In this case, it's Meghalaya. And see how in schools in Rugapara, one can start maybe 2-hour programs or 3-hour programs. And do we have a teacher? That is again a problem. That is why we are saying that, given the, this genetic fallacy, because when we, I already told you, there are three speakers in Rugapara who speak Ruga fluently. There are two full speakers and one semi speaker who has some problem with hearing. So, and they are all old people. So it may not be able, they may not be able to teach everything, but it is important for us to document all the wisdom, all the knowledge, what they have about their language and the culture. And probably we can, we should also train teachers who will learn this language. Train teachers means I'm not talking about professional school teachers or university teachers. Even among the community, there will be speakers who would like to, who are more eager to learn their language. Let them first be their teachers and then pass it on to the other people. So this is a long-term commitment, but it's something one has to do to save Ruga. Also, the concept of MLE in India, this is again not new. Many communities have done, in many states they did MLE, mother tongue based multilingual education. Andhra Pradesh started MLE in eight indigenous languages in 2004. This was for grade 4 and grade 5. In Odisha, it was done for 10 indigenous languages in 2006. That is over 500 schools in both cases, in Andhra Pradesh and Odisha. Also, there are more initiatives in Jharkhand, Assam and Chhattisgarh, and maybe in other parts of the country. I also would like to appreciate the work of another important institute in India, Kalinga Institute of Social Sciences in Odisha, abbreviated as KISS, its acronym is KISS. They do holistic tribal education. There is a residential school that teaches 13 indigenous languages of Odisha. That's a very interesting school. I have visited it a couple of times and they're doing a wonderful job. But of course, residential school, you may ask me, if you are removing little kids from their home environment and putting them in a residential school, won't it affect their cognitive development and other things? And that those things are entirely out of my discussion today, but there are of course such issues also. And besides this, there are many more smaller programs across the country. There are many issues and challenges that are in front of us again and again. We do not have trained teachers for all the languages. There are so many languages, and the UNESCO number, whatever the UNESCO number you saw, that may not be the real number, because you know very well, when people classify languages, sometimes dialects are also classified as languages or mother tongues, like there are differences. So the number keeps on changing. Why every year we see numbers, why the ethnologue gives a different number, why UNESCO Atlas gives a different number, and why also the Hawaii group on the catalog of endangered languages come out with different numbers, because we are still having issues with classification of a particular mother tongue or a variety of a speech, whether it is a language or a dialect or what is it. And next one is sustained commitment from elders. This is another issue, because in many communities, the number of elders are decreasing, and the elders who are leaving us, maybe they have not transmitted their language in its fullest form. There are many such communities. There are, of course, many communities where you have three or even four generations of fluent speakers. But my attention here is only to those communities where you see that the second and the third generation are not able to speak their language in their home. And also, another biggest issue with us is the state or district support network should be there if you want to revitalize. It is not a job of a handful of people, like the Ministry of Tribal Affairs or the there are many ministries associated with the development of tribal languages and affairs and culture, Ministry of Culture. So many ministries are there, but the central ministries probably should coordinate with the state or district, or in the other way around, the state or the district should approach the center for their support and expand its network and take up these challenging tasks and do whatever is possible to preserve and save the languages that are dormant. And also expand on existing work or resources. we will see what kind of work exists now and what kind of resources we have in India and how we can expand it. Funding is another big issue because for this kind of research, we do not have support. There are very few institutions like CIL and probably some of these central universities that have centers of endangered languages and language division in Kolkata. There are very few institutions in India that can take up such work with the help of funding from government. Otherwise, in many cases, there are individual researchers and also like organizations like CEL probably are still interested in doing a lot of work, but funding is one big obstacle for many of them. But what kind of resources do we have and what are people doing? Like most of the times, we said in the beginning, documentation, language and cultural documentation is the first step to revive a language. But when we document a language or a culture, what do? We go with a questionnaire and based on questionnaires developed by several projects, people elicit data and audio data covering words and sentences with some basic linguistic information, then folk narratives, interviews, village history, anthropological data, ethno-linguistic data, maybe sociolinguistic surveys, video data, again ceremonies, dance, so on and so forth, digital photographic data, because now we have modern technology, then we can get a photo book or something depicting the culture and daily life of the people, and then use that photo book to elicit more data, linguistically processed data with annotations. There are quite a bit of such things. But now the problem is going back to, I just want to go back to that slide again. I'm sorry. Here we said like, based on this, we have what people do in different projects, they come out with different resources. The resource, these are all, of course, we have a lot of language resources. With the help of this, the deliverables of this data will be like people come out with dictionaries. Right from early 90s, when we do language documentation, field linguistics, documentary linguistics, we produce grammars, and there will be sometimes a word list at the end of the grammar, or sometimes some independent projects for dictionary making are taken up. So basically, we get a grammar sketch, we get dictionary, we get some cultural data, like maybe it could be ethnolinguistics or ethnography or anthropological linguistics, or it could be sociolinguistics. So these are some of the things, but most of the times these resources produced materials which were beneficial more to the academic community in earlier days and less to the community directly. But for revitalization, we need to develop many things. So what happens, what do the communities need from us? What are their demands? Many times when now in modern days, when we go to field work or when we are staying with them for maybe for 2 weeks, 3 weeks, or some of you have the luxury and probably permission to work on a language for 6 months or 3 months doing some kind of immersion field work along with the community. But the demand from these communities are, we first need, many of the communities approached us in Karnataka too, for development of orthographies, writing systems. I would like to give one example from our own experience here. In Karnataka, there is a community, the language spoken by people in HD Kote, Betta Kurba is the name of the language. This Betta Kurba is spoken in three states, in Karnataka, Kerala and Tamil Nadu. But they don't have a writing system. And without writing system, they cannot develop anything for them. We cannot develop, and they also on their own, they cannot do it. They want to develop dictionaries. They want to develop some textbooks for their own kids to learn the language. Many things they want to do. So they approached us, and now it is not very easy to develop orthography. I will come to that in my next slide. But that is the first demand from many of the communities. Lexicography or dictionary project is the second demand from many of them, because they feel like owning a dictionary is something bringing pride to them. So they feel like, oh, I have a dictionary for, there are dictionaries for my language. So that is why they want to say like, please help us to make dictionaries. And you know very well, even this is not an easy task because many of the current dictionaries produced across our country, when we look at them, we see most of the times they are more like vocabularies, word lists, and may or may not be done with the help of lexicographers, or sometimes even lexicographic principles might have been violated. But still, one can have like glossaries or vocabularies or whatever, but this is one thing the community demands. And the other thing is everybody, most of the people, of course, who are socioeconomically better are asking, approaching us to develop mobile apps or digital apps for them. For example, they want a virtual keyboard. Suppose you have already developed a writing system, or there is already an existing writing system, then they are approaching us, can you help us to have our own virtual keyboard? Can we have an app for our own language or other digital apps, and so that they can expand their network with their community? And that is one way they can communicate with their fellow community members. And once you use the language more and more, the language gets a better chance of revival. Visibility in cyberspace, because nowadays people are using a lot of media like Facebook or Twitter or many other places. They want to use their type in their own language. Visibility not only for typing, but also a space. Like that is one thing I think India should do. Like maybe we should do, create a cyberspace for the all of our indigenous communities. Celebrate our indigenous communities and their languages and cultures. Because as you know that from 2022, we have the International Decade of Indigenous Languages. So we should utilize this time and create unique spaces for each community. For example, Khasi, or maybe we can have for Thado or Garo or Beta Kuruba or Thoda, any community, we should have a unique space where people can, it's their space. Like they should feel belongingness should be there, and there could be many things which can develop where they can share all their cultural and social and other knowledge with us. There are a lot of indigenous knowledge in different areas like flora, fauna, flora and fauna, very important because in they help in preparation of medicines and so many things. Many such things can be done. Grammars for community members. This is another important thing. Of course, the academicians are very much interested in bringing out descriptive grammars or typological grammars with phonology, morphology, and syntax, semantics. It's important to have the academic grammars for the academic benefit, I mean for the scientific community, but it is also important to also produce simple grammars for the benefit of the community members who don't require the linguistic jargon, but at the same time should know the structure of their language, how their language sounds like, what is the structure of the word, what is the structure of their sentence, word order, how, like all those things, how to, in other words, grammars for kids, grammars for teenagers, grammars for adults. One can come out with different packages here. This is also something one can do to help revive the language. Coming to orthography development, as I mentioned earlier, it is not very easy. In one of my own writings in 2017, I had proposed the significance and importance of setting up a committee. I named it as Orthography Development Committee, ODC, because it is not easy to develop orthography, and it is not the job of a linguist or a language activist or an NGO member to develop, to allot a script, or in other words, to propose a script. In this matter, even the government cannot have the word, because it's ultimately the script is going to be used by the community. Whatever we are doing, it is for the community. So it is important to give importance to them. So fluent mother tongue speakers should be in that committee in order to decide upon the script, what kind of script should be used. I cannot say because the language is spoken in South India, can we use a dominant region? For example, if it is Tamil Nadu, can we use Tamil script for all the indigenous languages spoken in Tamil Nadu may or may not be acceptable by the community. The same works for other states also. So we have to see that there are fluent mother tongue speakers belonging to various dialect groups and other different age groups who use the language for at least 2 decades, because they are the ones who will tell us which is the standard variety of that particular language, and then which ones to use, because we cannot decide upon that on our own. And community representatives should be part of this committee, the village headman or religious leaders, and members of the literary council or language association should be there. Linguists or language specialists, of course, because you need them, because when we elicit data, we are understanding the sound of the language, and then we are trying to make the sound form correspondence, which for this we need language specialists, especially specialists in phonology, phonetics and phonology. Government representatives, because it's very, very important. Without government, if suppose we develop a script and imagine the language policy of that particular country, in our case India, suppose there is no place for that, and suppose there are objections, then the whole effort will go waste. So it is very, very important at every stage of developing a writing system for a particular language which lacks a script, to form a committee and invite this ODC every now and then and resolve the issues, and then see what will be ideal, what kind of script will be ideal, what would be the good effective writing system for a particular language that does not have any system. Of course, when we talk about resources, the more the merrier. As much as we develop language and cultural resources for the community, by the academicians and by the community, and sometimes community alone also do, because those things are also happening in the world. And also it's important to create indigenous knowledge corpus. Technological empowerment of these languages is important. Access to indigenous materials, because in some cases communities may wish to restrict access, because every community may have certain rituals or certain activities which are kind of secret and which cannot be shared to everybody. That access will be made available only to a select few members of the community. But we can do all such things using technology, how we can do it, and it is important to make all these things available. What are the measures to preserve identity? Having language rights alone cannot guarantee language maintenance. This depends on the home language choices of native speakers. So we have to ensure intergeneration transmission at home, because even though it is difficult, but it is important that we speak our mother tongue with our children and ensure that they also speak it with their playmates who are from the same community. So it is important to make the home language choice. In other words, family language planning, and it should begin at home. Transmission and getting official status could be easier if schools are established to teach such languages to the present generation. And also language should be used in newspapers, signs and billboards on roads, official communication, mother tongue education, at least in primary level. Also organize festivals and events to promote culture, because identity is not just preserving the language, it is also preserving the cultural identity. And these festivals, I am now seeing during the pandemic days, in Latin America, many of the festivals, the community festivals, are being held virtually. It's very interesting that since there is social or physical distancing, people are doing it virtually. It's very important to organize such things so that culture can be promoted. Cultural sustainability is one of the priority initiative, as mentioned by the Smithsonian Center for Folklore and Cultural Heritage in its 2014 strategic plan. Neither culture nor sustainability is a transparent or simple concept. Cultural sustainability is a generative, reciprocal research practice that fosters relationships, engenders knowledge about the socio-cultural ecology, and guides diverse ethical interventions that enhance the vitality and well-being of specific communities and cherished aspects of their expressive lives. I think it's important for our country, India, to also identify cultural sustainability and make it as one of the priority initiatives in order to preserve the language and culture. Of course, I'm not going into the details of intangible cultural heritage, but this term is put forward by UNESCO. It is important to document and utilize intangible cultural heritage for revitalization of languages and cultures. It's important to build resources for research and for community users. Language technology planning is important. Family language planning and community-based language planning is essential. Language technology planning will certainly open doors for the language use in text editors, online dictionaries, talking dictionaries, cell phones, etc. Build virtual boards with the help of the community. Develop mobile apps for day-to-day communication in social media, such as email, WhatsApp, Facebook, Twitter. Construct websites for the linguistic families and subfamilies of the region and facilitate the upload of multimedia information about linguistic, cultural, and other ethnic knowledge of the societies. Building talking dictionaries of cognate languages with the goal of promoting multilingualism on one hand and providing space for the development of Indian individual languages on the other hand is important. We should allow the communities to build own languages. There are many softwares for that. VSAI is one of them, and afterwards academicians along with specialists in lexicography can sit together and build a proper dictionary that can be printed or shared online. One could also develop MOOCs and other online teaching materials for these languages in a bi or multilingual environment. Create e-boards for the community folks to stay connected with each other. Make films and TV programs, because it's very important. This sometimes I feel sad, like we are proud to say we are multilingual India, multicultural, but we don't have channels for all the languages spoken in our country. It's very important. Why don't we have channels, if not for all, at least for many of the indigenous languages? Because this is something we should pay attention, because sometimes we see it gives me pain sometimes when I see movies in, even in my own mother tongue Tamil, there will be one or two songs where there will be some indigenous communities somewhere they sing, or the hero and the heroine are talking somewhere and suddenly they meet some indigenous community and there will be a dance sequence. I feel sad to see such things, even though that is one way of promoting other language or culture, but still, why can't we make movies? Why can't we have channels? So I really become emotional about this point. So I'm just going to leave this for the discussion with the whole group here. All these things could be achieved with the help of fluent speakers and could be used in families and communities to transmit their language across generations. Like Strubel noted, John, the way people bring up their families, including the language they choose, is not for the authorities to decide. Because the way people bring up their families is their business, right? So likewise, we have to see that how we can collaborate with our community people and revitalize their language. I'm not going to play this song because I see already I have taken a lot of time, but there are some languages, some communities have created or found space in the virtual world, in cyberspace. Atong comedy is there. I feel these are the things we should be doing more and more, in addition to producing dictionaries, grammars, ethnolinguistic surveys or social linguistic surveys. This kind of corpus, like every language has comedy, and why can't we share the joy of this comedy with others too? So Atong comedy, if you're interested, Atong songs are there in YouTube. Actually, there is no time to play this, otherwise it is already, the link is there, but if there is anyone wants to listen, we will come back to this afterwards. I would like to conclude so that we can have some discussion. I just wanted to say that we should document as much as possible, oral, written, digital, anything and everything what we come across, and with the help of the community. Please do not do anything without the consent of the community. Descriptions for academic purposes, for community and for others. Also help the communities revitalize the languages that are dormant. It is very essential to technologically empower the less resourced language. These are the references I have used. And thanks for your attention. Yes, yeah. Thank you for your attention, everybody.
Thank you very much, Uma. So there are some questions in the chat box. Do you want to read them yourself, or you want me to read them and you would like to answer this?
Yeah, you can also read, or I can read it here, no problem. But if I miss something, maybe you can help me.
Yeah, sure.
Because I'm just scrolling down the chat here. Okay, Amir Ali has asked, I want to ask a question. Since publishers hardly give any value to a revitalized language, this may cause devitalization of a revitalized language, a process in reverse. What do you suggest with respect to preserving a revitalized language, given a very low demand for the language in the arena of linguistic economy? If such a process does occur, how can we, the advocates of revitalization, counter it? Okay, see, like I said in the beginning itself, number one, we are first helping the community to save their language. That is about priority. Of course, we also have UNSEEK academic, some recognition so that other you take it to the larger academic community for various reasons. I think things will change, but there are publishers and there are journals. For example, there is a journal called Language Documentation and Conservation, published by University of Hawaii. I believe they do publish some articles on any efforts of revitalization. And I'm currently the editor of Indian Linguistics, but so far we have not received any article on any revitalization. We will be happy to consider that, and we will follow the process of peer reviewing everything. I do believe that in our country also one can find some scope for publication, and we will also bring books and other. It's not just publication in a journal. Maybe you can bring out books and make some other materials also. These are also publications. One can find some such sources also. We will talk more about it, but it is possible to do, and low demand for the language should change. That is our goal. That is something you have asked, like if given a very low demand. Like I told you, we are going to celebrate a decade, full decade, 10 years celebrating indigenous languages. In these 10 years, our country, maybe we can take it up with the authorities concerned, whether it is government or whether it is academics or any other authority, and see to that celebrating these languages in fullest form. That means even this low demand should become a high demand. And like today, we are talking about Maori. Everybody knows about Maori. Like that, tomorrow somebody should talk about Ruga, or some other language which is completely unknown to the rest of the world. The next one is, I'm going down to the next question. The market value of dominant languages attracts the people to learn them. Meanwhile, local languages or endangered languages do not have market value, or market value is not created by government for their teacher or expert of the Indian language, indigenous languages. Don't you think that we, scholars and students of linguistics, have ignored market value of indigenous languages? So you're saying that local languages or endangered languages do not have a market value. So our market value is not created by government. Actually, I cannot completely agree with this statement. I wouldn't say ignored, but of course the scope is limited. That is what I think, that is why Muzaffar Hussain is asking this question. The scope is limited. We should, of course, I would not use the word market value. Maybe you can answer me. Maybe you are thinking about employment opportunities for these people, or is it just the value for the language itself? That part you have to tell. But as scholars and students of linguistics, we have ignored market value of indigenous language. We are not ignoring, but I think the process is a bit slow in our country. Again and again, we have to take care of these languages. and we have to do our best, whatever it requires. If necessary, have a dialogue with the state governments and the central government and see what can be done for promotion of these languages. So then another question is, what persuasive or discourse strategies would you suggest when a speech community does not look positively at the utility of its own language? I think the suggestion was given in one of my slides, culture therapy and language therapy, because we have to do the language culture connection and culture therapy, because it's, and also probably make them understand what is happening. Like I understand the their own agony and pain. If my language is not used, or not, if I'm not being allowed to use my languages like you do for some other language, the scheduled language, then what can I do? So maybe they are demotivated in many ways and they have this negative language attitude, but we have to work closely with the community and